Good morning, dear friends. At the outset, I would like to thank Laxmi Madam, dear friend Jaydeep, and for a very good morning here. We had a nice discussion at the table. And thank you, Vedi, for your elaborate explanation, because preconception, if we are able to offer good care, preconception care, then the fertility, subfertility problem goes down. So as we discussed on our table, if we have to talk about what are the most important supplements which help, supplements, usually we think of medicine, but not really. The literature clearly says that patients who have high BMI, in those patients, exercise, diet, good adequate sleep, and stress-free habits, they contribute in a very significant way, to the tune of almost 35 to 40% over a period of 1 year, which improves their fertility outcome. Patients, if you are made too aware of simple lifestyle changes that could impact their fertility, they are generally receptive to make those adjustments. So another important point which came out of the discussion, that you need to customize, because most of our literature which we go through is a foreign literature. We need to customize as per our client age. If I am practicing in a periphery, if I have to talk about the jogger to my lady who's working in fields, it is not going to work. If from an orthodox family some couple are there, then a lady cannot go out for a walk, so how she can do it at home? So something like skipping, going on a terrace, get up early in the morning, or when the entire senior people of the family, they sleep off, then you can do exercise. Another important aspect which we talk about, that our food is very rich in sugar content. We have almost like, you know, 70 to 80 festivals in a year, then birthdays, anniversaries, deaths. So many factors are there where we eat extra. But how many times anyone goes for an extra exercise? Routinely people don't do exercise, so it is very difficult to talk about the extra exercise. So we need to emphasize, you know, I take it as, you know, 20% of our consultation time has to be pushed for these important parameters, because over a period of, you know, 4 or 5 consultations, at least 35 to 50% of the patients, they start with something. Reducing, or, you know, I say that, you know, you have to leisure your calorie intake. So how much you are eating and how much you are exercising. If you want to eat something which you like, you have to exercise first, or you have to fast in the morning or a prior evening, and then go that way. Lot of pharma people, they come with prescription. Like CoQ is something which is very commonly used in our fertility practice, almost for everyone, male, female, with different combinations. There is not strong evidence to recommend taking it at this point to improve fertility. That is what the literature says. Women should be advised to take folic acid supplementation. That it has a clear evidence to support that, you know, 20% of them, there is fertility improvement. Doubling in the follicular folate level was associated with threefold increase in the pregnancy rate. So we must give folic acid supplementation to all our patients who are undergoing fertility care. This is another molecule which is very commonly been prescribed, though it has been very clearly marketed by pharma people for low responders, people, young couple who have, young lady who has got low AMH, but it has been prescribed to each and every one. Patients in the DHA group also had a significantly higher live birth rate compared with controls, if properly selected patients. The Cochrane review says that in women identified as poor responders undergoing ART, pre-treatment with DHEA or testosterone may be associated with improved live birth rates. The overall quality of the evidence is moderate, so it has to be used judiciously, like that testosterone as well. There is insufficient data to support a beneficial role of recombinant LH, HCG, DHEA or letrozole administration in the probability of pregnancy in poor responders undergoing ovarian stimulation for IVF. Growth hormone. The role of growth hormone to treat a woman with a poor response to ovarian stimulation cannot be supported on the basis of the available evidence. Now, British Fertility Society recommends that there is no convincing evidence for the use of and safety of IVIG as adjuvants in the woman with recurrent implantation failure embarking on IVF. Lack of evidence for use of anti-TFNα agents. Lack of evidence to recommend intralipid infusion therapy as an adjuvant in IVF. There's limited evidence that corticosteroids may improve pregnancy rates in women undergoing conventional IVF and in the subgroup of women with autoimmunity or unexplained implantation failure. There is lack of evidence of an NTG sildenafil to be used in IVF failure. Lack of proven efficacy in the routine use of aspirin as an adjuvant in IVF. Another important molecule which has been used is metformin. Metformin may have some beneficial effects in women with PCOS undergoing IVF by reducing the risk of developing OHSS and increasing clinical pregnancy rate. The Cochrane review says that no conclusive evidence that metformin treatment before or during ART cycles improved live birth rates in women with PCOS. However, the use of this insulin sensitizing agent increased clinical pregnancy rates and decreased the risk of OHSS. The ESHRAE guidelines says that routine use of adjuvant metformin before and during ovarian stimulation is not recommended with the GnRH antagonist protocol. Use of testosterone and DHEA before ovarian stimulation is probably not recommended for poor responders. Use of aspirin as well. I thank you for your patient hearing.